Hello, everyone. Welcome back to the CASI Fall Seminar Series. My name is Amrita. Sharad, Tariq, and I co-organized the seminar series. I will be your host for today. Before we commence the talk, a plug-in for next week's hybrid event with Rukmini S., who is an independent data journalist from Chennai and a visiting scholar at CASI. She'll be talking to us about data and democracy deficits in India. You can find the details of the event on the CASI website. A word about logistics. The speaker will talk for 30 to 35 minutes, which will be followed by Q&A. If you have a question, please drop your question or intimate me using the chat function. Today's event is co-sponsored by the program in Gender, Sexuality, and Women's Studies and the Center for Feminist, Queer, and Transgender Studies, along with South Asia Center, Penn Development Research Initiative, and the Sociology and Anthropology Department. Lastly, it gives me great pleasure to introduce today's speaker, Smitha Radhakrishnan, to you. Smitha Radhakrishnan is the Lula Lamer Professor of Women's Studies and Professor of Sociology at Wellesley College. Her research examines the cultural, financial, and political dimensions of gender and globalization, with particular focus on India, the United States, and South Africa. She's the author of Appropriately Indian, Gender and Culture in a Transnational Class, published by Duke University Press in 2011. She has co-authored a book with Gauri Vijay Kumar called Sociology of South Asia, Post-Colonial Legacies, Global Imaginaries, published by Palgrave in 2022. Her talk today draws from her most recent book, Making Women Pay, Microfinance in Urban India, published by Duke University Press in 2022. She'll also be talking to us about the new directions she plans to take alongside this project. Her talk is entitled, The Invisibilized State, How Empowered Women Saved India's Financial Inclusion Agenda. Welcome, Smitha, and I look forward to your talk.
Thank you so much. It's really wonderful to be here. And thank you, Amrita, for the invitation. And I'm excited to hear what all of you think about this. So this is actually from one particular chapter in the book. It was the most difficult chapter for me to write. It was the one that took the longest and was the most laborious to actually assemble the ideas for. But perhaps surprisingly, the hard work, or unsurprisingly, I don't know, it ended up being the thing which I'm planning, which I found to be most insightful for the project as a whole in terms of where I wanted to go later in terms of thinking comparatively about a next project. So I'm gonna lay out the findings and kind of the key things that I wanna say about this chapter, why I think they're significant, and how this particular chapter and its methodology and the hidden financial architecture that it revealed for me is paving the way to my next project. All right, so this is my book that came out, Making Women Pay. As it turns out, Duke is having a 50% off sale. So if this is something that you haven't had a chance to get a hold of, please go check it out. It is on sale through the end of December at a discount price. The book is mostly ethnographic, but the chapter that I'm going to present to you today is based on historical analysis of Reserve Bank documents and policy histories. So I was telling Amrita, it's like a little nerdy for me, like I'm already nerdy, but it's like very extreme. But I hope that people find points of engagement for it. All right. So when I started out, one of the motivations for this project, perhaps the key motivation for this project, was looking at the rapid expansion of commercial debt in especially urban India, but also in rural India. And when I got into the context, the thing which became very apparent is it's not just that there were lots of companies, but that rural and urban India is saturated in gendered debt. They were talking about urban and rural communities in India that have now come to the point that they rely on debt that targets women in order to make ends meet. And this is true for both working class and poor women, poor families. And this has actually been understudied. It seems like there is a burgeoning and too big literature on microfinance, but in fact, the details of how the sector actually works, what the policies are that drive it, why it works in the way that it does, there's actually very little scholarship on it. So it's one of those things where it appears that it's abundant, but the way that it's framed misleads us into thinking about what's actually there. So in India, what am I talking about when I say that there's an abundance of debt? Well, first, there's self-help group debt. This is debt that came out of national policies from NABARD, the National Agricultural and Rural Development Bank, and that organizes women into small groups and links them to an actual bank. An actual bank, when I say that, I'm talking about a mainstream state-supported bank. These are like Punjab National Bank, like banks that are state-led and state-supported. Now, the newer kind of debt that is swimming around in both rural and urban India is debt from microfinance institutions, or what I'll refer to for the rest of the talk as MFIs. And these are commercial institutions. They have a for-profit, they're profit-oriented commercial firms. They bring debt to the doorsteps of women. And it's not, so they're not going through an intermediary to get that linkage to the bank. The bank is coming directly to them. Now, what is perhaps surprising is that both of these kinds of debt are state sanctioned. So when you talk to people who are in the microfinance sector, they believe that they are doing something entirely private that has nothing to do with the state. But when you look more closely at the context in which MFIs came to be and how they expanded, the state is actually very heavily involved both in funding the MFI sector and regulating it. And so I'm going to explain why these two forms of debt are so enmeshed with one another and why they point us to looking at financial histories and financial geographies of inequality in India. All right, so this area is new to you, these are just a few of the commercial microfinance firms that have cropped up in India in the last two decades. I did do research in some of these, which I have used pseudonyms for in the actual book, but not all of them. But this gives you a sense that there are many, many firms that are competing. In a big city like Chennai or Bangalore, you might have four or five of these companies competing for the very same clients in an urban neighborhood. So when I say saturated, I really mean that there are a multiplicity of corporate as well as government actors that are trying to give loans to the same women. And these are all the commercial organizations. There are state-led organizations that are in there as well. So one of the key questions that I started out with this research is one that seems quite obvious, but is actually not examined very often. Why is it that state-sanctioned financial services target women? Why do they target women and not men? If you look at Latin America, microfinance institutions target men and women equally. If you look at Southeast Asia, you see that over time they started targeting women, but over time became more gender equitable. Why is it that in India, is it still 96% of women, 96% of microfinance loans that go to women? What I found is that when you actually talk to people in the industry, there is an unquestioned assumption that small loans should go to women and not to men. People don't actually think that that's something you can ask a question about. It's like an obvious, like, well, of course we can't lend to men, which is of course where I started getting curious about, well, there must be a reason for that, but I have to uncover that. So my question was really about where this prevailing orthodoxy comes from. It is pervasive when you talk to people who are within banks, even at the very upper levels, the idea of loaning to men, they just say, oh, but they'll never pay back. We can't loan to men. It's been tried and it's failed. We don't loan to men. So I wanted to look into this a little bit more. Now, what I found is that if we look at the policy histories, there is a key convergence. There is a convergence between programs oriented towards women's empowerment and completely separate programs oriented towards financial inclusion. So what I hope to convince you of, partly, and I'll give you a little bit more information about what I want to convince you of, is that women's empowerment, that focus, that it became more very recently the focus of financial inclusion efforts, and that kind of saved national efforts to further financial inclusion, which had been stalled or ineffective for over a century. So what I'm arguing is that we can't think about microfinance as its own special product, but rather part and parcel of a much broader and larger history to include India's masses in the formal financial system. The focus on gender debt, however, displaced other programs to improve women's well-being and access to vital resources and services. So there were many other ways in which not just NABARD, but many other movements and government policies sought to bring resources and services to women around a radical women's empowerment agenda. But the success of these financially oriented institutions, or the proliferation of them, actually ended up displacing some of those programs, so that now both women's empowerment and financial inclusion have become the same thing. So what I hope to argue or lay out for you today is that the current state of this gendered financial ecosystem that we have in India today, that it comes from a multi-layered colonial and post-colonial history in which successive governments have tried to provide banking and financial services to marginalized groups, and most recently to women in particular. And so what that has meant for women is that their position has shifted. Where previously women were completely excluded from financial services and products, they are now the object of those products and have, or they're the subject, I guess, because they're being extracted from, and now they are the subjects of extraction. The policy changes that have occurred since liberalization, since the liberalization of the banking sector really in the 90s, have enmeshed the nationalized banking system with the interests of private financial companies, such that those two now cannot be viewed as separate. And that's what I'm hoping to convince you of. So what that has meant in practical terms, if we're talking about a concern with working class women and their livelihoods, is a significant transfer of moral and political imperative, the moral and political imperative to include women in the financial system to commercial financial companies. So it's now commercial firms who are doing that work and not the government. So we can talk about this as outsourcing, or we can talk about it as devolving that responsibility, or, you know, I think there's many different words that you can use, but it's no longer, they pretty much just handed it over onto the shoulders of commercial firms. This transfer has thus produced that saturation of gender debt that requires the extraction of value, not just financial value, but also symbolic value from marginalized groups of women. So that's what I'm hoping to convince you of. Now, why does this matter? When we theorize financialization and the expansion of the financial system, we actually need to recognize how the actions of private firms and state policies work together, and that the state itself is not a unified actor. So for example, what NABARD does in the area of financial inclusion and gendered empowerment is not necessarily working in concert with what the RBI or the Reserve Bank of India does, and that those things can actually unwittingly produce outcomes that deepen or entrench women's marginalization further. It also shows how implicit or explicit gender politics of financial policies really matter for the understanding of our financial system. When we think about financial policy, it's ungendered, it is non-specific, but in fact, these have real geographic implications in terms of the geographies of inequality, but also particular impacts on women themselves. All right, so to convince you of this, I'm gonna go through four key time periods. I'm gonna try to spend a little bit more time on the more recent ones, but I'm happy to answer questions about the earlier ones, just in order to be able to focus our presentation a little bit more and let you know the new direction that I'm going on that I'd like to get your feedback on. All right, so these are the four time periods: British experiments with social banking, post-colonial community banking and its decline, and then liberalization and the new regulated MFI sector that emerges in the last 10 years or so. All right, so the first moment has to do with British experiments in social banking. And I'm not gonna go into too much depth here, except to say that the British were extremely disturbed by the indebtedness of the peasantry way back in the 19th century. They tried to do lots of things to create cooperative banks. They did it very much in tandem, like many other institutions that the British created. They were creating them in India at the same time that they were creating them in Britain. So you see a huge growth, proliferation of cooperative banking in rural areas under the British. And it created the world's largest cooperative banking system. Now, what happened, though, is that this didn't really include as many people as one would think. At the same time, you had caste-based banks that were operating within caste communities, but these were also very exclusive, right? Those British banks really didn't produce okay, I'm going to say this, actually the second point first, right? It didn't necessarily produce relationships of trust. These banks were poorly managed. They really targeted British who were in India and the most privileged sections. The majority remained in debt traps. More importantly, women were not targeted as a vulnerable group within these policies. They were assumed to be a part of peasant families, and there weren't really any explicit policies that bothered about women needing financial services. However, what it did do is it set up this stratified banking system that we still have today, where the most privileged in society have access to financial services, and those who are more marginalized do not have the kinds of relationships that are required to actually gain access to those services. So jump ahead to independence. And what you see is the post-independence government being extremely concerned about this issue and saying, okay, the British didn't get it right, but we're gonna get it right. So you see an unprecedented level of outreach in rural areas at the towards, you know, after independence. And yet by 1954, really only 9% of peasants in rural areas are using banking services. So then there's another big push in 1969, all the banks are nationalized, and that sets in motion huge changes to expand access in rural areas, including very strict licensing requirements. So these licensing requirements said that, all right, if you open one bank or one branch in an urban area, you have to open four in a rural area, right, in order to be able to make sure that that access is fair. And this was very limiting for bank expansion, but this was the way that things rolled out. The other thing that happens during this period, which I'll talk about in more detail later, is the creation of a priority lending sector. So the national government sets up a set of regulations, it's the Reserve Bank actually, that says, okay, mainstream banks, you need to reserve about 40% of your debt for those priority sectors or those marginalized sectors who have not been allowed access to this finance in the past. So that regulation ends up getting created. Perhaps unsurprisingly, no bank ever meets this criteria for the next 30, 40 years. But what it did create was a large culture of mass disbursement that targeted men. So during this period, you have like loan melas, where banks are going and basically handing loans out to men. And these are not necessarily rural men who understand what is required in order to be able to take this loan, don't necessarily understand the requirements, et cetera. And so what ended up happening is most of those loans that were handed out were never repaid. And it creates a massive shortfall that eventually all the banks write off, right? So basically a huge effort, nothing really comes out of it. And during this entire period, women are largely excluded. So what are some of the outcomes of this? It creates a culture of unreliable rural men, the perception that rural men cannot be trusted with loans. What you do see importantly, however, if we care about vulnerability in marginalized areas, is that in Bihar, in certain regions which had been really targeted for expansion, you do see some reduction in vulnerability. And this has been pretty well documented that when those services were provided and available, hunger levels decline, people are able to hang on to their land for longer, there's less land dispossession. There's some important things that happen that suggest that these work to some extent. And then it leaves this priority sector legacy that then becomes an instrument that's used in the period after liberalization, and I'll talk about that in a moment. So what happens now in moment three? This is really, we're getting towards the 90s, I'm kind of running through this here. You see a pivot to gendered extraction. So first big thing that happens in the early 2000s, the World Bank, after Grameen and after having all this evidence about microfinance working in lots of other parts of the world, it provides a $110 million loan. Doesn't seem like a lot, but it's just given to Andhra Pradesh, which has done some innovative things around this. And it says, we're gonna support you in the rollout of self-help group-based loans, right? These are the government flavor loans that go and link them to formal banks. Now, by 2006, 2.2 million households are organized into over 170,000 self-help groups. Radical change in a very short period of time. When I was on the ground talking to people who were involved with this, they say, you know, it was like a flash, right? Like 1 minute, nobody knew what this meant, taking a group loan. And, you know, within 2 minutes, it felt like everyone was doing it, right? Now, the Andhra Pradesh government follows up with this Indira Kranti Patham program, which by 2010 establishes another 1 million groups in Andhra Pradesh. And Andhra Pradesh becomes the epicenter of the microfinance kind of revolution, if you can call it that, in India. So between, now what's happening in parallel here? They're not doing this in a vacuum. By 2007 to 2010, a bunch of NGOs which said, you know what, these self-help groups, they're kind of limited. Let's try to find a different way to deliver these loans to women. They start becoming financialized. By 2010, they are attracting hundreds of millions of dollars in foreign equity, ballooning their portfolios to $2 billion by 2010. This has become a completely different space by this time. And it ends up becoming its own asset class in India. And it is, these are still unregulated, called non-banking financial institutions, NBFIs is what they're called for, and they're still called that actually, but now there's some other classes, but I won't get into that. So what are the outcomes of this time period? Well, women's self-help groups come to the center of national financial inclusion policy. Now, the only way that Andhra Pradesh governments and other state governments around India are thinking about financial inclusion has to do with these self-help groups. And they're actually competing with private money and private financial companies to lend out as much money as possible. And now women have become solely responsible for household debt. This was not the case before. What you have, secondly, is a change in 2004, which to my knowledge, no one else has turned this up, but a lot of like combing through RBI circular turned this up. In my interview data, I kept hearing people talk about a change that happened in 2004, 2005, that in one moment, the government, the MFIs did not have enough money to lend out, and suddenly they had lots of it. I couldn't figure out what happened. Digging, I find that in 2004, the RBI made a small change. And basically the change was that regular banks, mainstream state-sanctioned banks, state-owned banks, that they could fulfill their priority sector lending requirement by giving that money to MFIs. And this is where the convergence happens, right? Because at this point, it's a small, obscure change to policy. But before this, MFIs had lots of foreign equity, but they couldn't use that to lend it out to clients because India has very strict regulations about the separation of equity capital and debt capital. And they do not allow, under Indian regulations, even though MFIs could take all of those millions of dollars of foreign equity and use it to build branches and upgrade their management, their information systems, and buy new iPads for the people who were going out in the field, right? They could not actually take that money and lend it to Indian citizens. But when this change happens, suddenly, instead of going and begging banks for debt capital, those banks are calling them and saying, hey, can we give you this money because it fulfills our PSL? And we hear you guys have a really good deal going on where women actually pay back. So it's a good deal for us, good deal for you. Now that capital can become profitable, right? And the banks give a huge billions, right, to MFIs to disperse to women in rural areas. So microcredit and women's initiatives end up merging, and it sets up an overlending situation that balloons and leads to a significant crisis in 2010 that really starts in Andhra Pradesh, but shakes up the industry at large, kind of the wild west of ballooning interest rates ends up kind of coming to a crashing halt when, and now I used to know the number at the tip of my tongue and I didn't put it into this presentation, but something like 9 million or 10 million households just do not repay. By some accounts, it is the largest non-repayment in history. Millions of people in Andhra Pradesh just don't pay back their MFI loans, and the banks are in a very tricky situation. Now, in that particular situation, they end up going to the RBI for relief and saying, hey, you know what? Actually, we're cool with regulation. Let us, like, please regulate us now. And it ends up that the leaders of the top MFIs end up really in conversation with the RBI about what kind of regulation they want. And we can talk about what that interaction looked like, because, you know, one has to ask whether the people who need to be regulated should be the ones writing the regulations. But anyway, so what ends up happening in 2004, or sorry, in moment four, what I'm calling moment four, is the emergence of a regulated MFI sector. So this is an important thing, right? So the MFI's profit-oriented ambitions, oh, it should say ambitious, not ambitious, are chastened by the Malagam report. So this is Malagam. He and does this huge committee report at the national level, right? And starts, setting up very clear regulations around interest rates, around who can get loans and who can't, whole bunch of regulations that never existed before. But what I found is that MFIs actually had significant influence over the final shape of those regulations, and it didn't necessarily change what had become the feminization of indebtedness, right? Microfinance continues to be viewed as an instrument of women's empowerment, and women continue to be the ones who manage debt in their households, right? The new regulations don't mention women at all. They don't recognize the extent to which this new debt relied upon women's reliability, the fact that they pay back 90% of the time, except when in a crisis, their vulnerability and their rootedness to their neighborhoods. These things are not addressed at all in the report. There's really nothing much about women at all, just that these institutions are doing a great job bringing, extending and doing financial inclusion, and therefore they regulate them and the industry regroups and carries on as usual. Okay, I'm conscious of the time. So let me just say that the outcomes of this is that these small loans become normalized as state policy. It also enriches financial corporations, and the profit margins in these firms after a dip ends up going up again. And it doesn't change something very fundamental, which is the assumption of a heteropatriarchal family in which women bring in loans to support the family. And if this is something people want to talk about, I can discuss it further. You know, I talked to policymakers and looked at, documents that really suggest that, and looked at the everyday practices of MFIs. Women can't take these loans on their own. They can only do it when the husband provides verification, when there is another source of income that's coming in. Even the people who designed this say, well, this is not a feminist policy. It's a livelihoods policy where men and women come together and share resources. So it really is making women the people, right, who are in charge of not just managing debt, right, but managing the finances of the entire household, and the buck really ends up resting with them. Programs that are supporting the enhancement of women's livelihoods, job creation, education, property rights, all of these are sidelined and become not as important as making sure that women are the ones who are managing debt in their lives. So what does this mean for our thinking about the invisibilized state? I hope that I've been able to convince you is that these efforts, that this is sort of part of a longer history. It's not just something that happened after Grameen Bank, that there have been efforts to reach the peasantry, really, that where it originates, that long excluded women. But when they finally turned to women, to including women, they did so without a holistic understanding of livelihoods and the labor market, but rather focused only on debt. The reliability of women as borrowers, the fact that women repay, right, at such a high rate is rooted in gender inequality. But rather than alleviating that gender inequality by enhancing property rights, by enhancing access to the labor market, the expansion of microlending actually deepens and reinforces that fundamental structural inequality. Women become the subject of debt and the object of empowerment. They perform empowerment for everybody else, but they are the ones who must be subject to constantly finding a way to repay. And this leads to this other part, which is that gendered inequalities are in fact very productive for financial policies that seek to expand the financial systems, and those inequalities have been leveraged and deepened for the smooth functioning of that system rather than alleviated. All right, so that leads me to my new work, which I'm right now calling Patterns of Predatory Inclusion. So I'll walk you a little bit through what I'm thinking about here. This is a comparative project where I'm thinking about India, the US, and South Africa. I come to them from new questions that emerge for me from my exploration of Indian microfinance histories. The first question is a fundamental one, and one that I probably, you know, lots of people are asking in different contexts, but I come to it from this particular vantage point. Do policies that are intended to put money in the hands of the marginalized actually end up in the hands of those that they intend to? What is clear from looking at the history of microfinance is that, you know, billions of dollars and rupees are floating around, but the profit of those actually end up with financial, you know, the captains of financial companies, with the companies themselves. The profit of that money is not necessarily resting with the women who take the loans, who are paying huge interest rates and who are in a cycle of debt payment and repayment, and not necessarily gaining the benefit of that money, whether it's and it's flowing both from state as well as from private sources. This question about, you know, where does the money go? There's also more specific questions. How do cash assistance and exploitative debt overlap in the lives of working class women? And I'll tell you why I asked that question from some anecdotes that came out of my ethnographic work. But this question that we can't just look at debt in a vacuum, we also need to look at it in relation to other kinds of cash that are floating around in women's lives. And second, and this broader question of how financial inclusion could be reproducing geographies of inequalities along lines of race, caste, and gender. All right, so my new project, I'm looking at these three locations. I'm looking at the US, particularly the South, looking at TANF, which is temporary aid to needy families, and how that overlaps with credit card debt. And I think that they are incredibly parallel, and there's a lot to suggest that the history of credit card expansion, the fact that they are available to lots of needy folks now in ways that they weren't 20 or 30 years ago, overlaps with the very poor provision of TANF in the US. And I'll give you a little bit, this is actually what I've started working on so far with this project. Now, what's interesting is in South Africa is that this is another context which is quite different. Here you have an extensive, unlike the US, program of grant, entitlement-based grants from old age to, you know, pensions of various kinds, disability grants, but you also have a very entrenched exploitative debt system, right, that comes mostly from private companies. And there is some new research that does in fact look at how these two overlap, and I'm interested in uncovering the policy histories that made that possible. And then finally in India, you've got NREGA, the National Rural Employment Guarantee Act, perhaps the largest cash assistance program in the world, and you have microfinance. And my hunch is that these overlap in ways that are pretty significant, although they haven't been looked at before. So briefly, what I know, and here is where I would love to hear from folks about your hunch about whether this will pan out or not. You know, the Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Act might be the largest cash assistance program in the world. There's a huge literature about it. I have not yet found, although if someone has, please let me know, any research that looks at how women who receive NREGA support manage debt. What kind of loans do they take out? Do they qualify for them? How are they managing that in the context of a larger, larger questions about their livelihoods? NREGA policies be further entrenching women's roles as part-time workers and mothers who are responsible for household financial management, which is the rhetoric that's used in MFIs and on the ground to really justify the work that women are doing in managing household debt. And finally, what's the relationship between financial inclusion policies that are out there and NREGA benefits? You know, again, how do those converge or diverge in real settings? So why I think that there's some traction here comes from my field work. So I did a lot of work in trainings, empowerment, entrepreneurial trainings, financial literacy trainings, et cetera. And one of the big challenges that the trainers faced was getting women to come, right? And this was true. I did a lot of work in urban areas, but I also did work in these semi-urban areas, which are kind of on the outskirts of towns or just outside them, where there's still a lot of agriculture. And what I found is that the trainers were always complaining that women were going and doing NREGA work, that they were going and getting their daily wage rather than coming to the trainings, and that they couldn't convince them to come and take a training about, you know, entrepreneurial, an entrepreneurial training about how to be oneself most and how to become an entrepreneur or how to get financial literacy, that this was a real source of frustration. So, you know, and I heard this over and over again in multiple contexts, and it suggests to me that the scope of NREGA may be larger than what we think, that it's not just about rural areas, but perhaps some of these semi-urban areas as well. And that there is a very high likelihood that women who are getting NREGA are also managing various kinds of debt, whether it's self-help group debt, or whether it is MFI debt or other kinds of predatory lending. And so there's a whole set of questions that I think deserve further exploration. Now, what I'm also interested in is that Indian microfinance and its history prompts new questions about the US that scholars in the US are not really asking. Where do funds intended for the marginalized actually go, whether they come from private sources or government sources? Since we know that a very small percentage of the funds for US families experiencing poverty actually go to that number, and I have a lot of other graphs about that, but I didn't want to bring that in because of time. Basically, for every 100 families that are experiencing poverty in the US, only about 20 of them actually get cash assistance. The rest of that money, which is specifically for cash assistance, goes to a host of other programs that have nothing to do with poor families. So the question of how are these families getting by? How might access to exploitative credit be shaping their livelihoods is a question that needs to be asked. There are also critical questions about gender, race, and geography and how they shape the intersection of debt and welfare that also need to be asked in the US context. And you know, I kind of know to ask them because of what I see in India. In the US South, what you see is much lower levels of the allocated funds for TANF actually going to alleviate poverty than in states where there are lower Black populations. So when there are greater Black populations, less money actually goes to those families. When there are lower Black populations, then more actually goes out in the form of cash assistance, right? So there are these really interesting and troubling ways in which patterns of cash assistance deepen inequality, and that Black women are actually being expelled from the limited safety net that exists. So these are questions that US scholars are not asking because policy conversations about credit and debt are very isolated from policy conversations about welfare, reproductive rights, and livelihoods. And there's something about the way that these come together in India that for me really directs me to look at those questions in the US in ways that US-based scholars are not looking at it. So Amrita, should I, I think maybe I can wrap up here. I can talk a little bit about the US, but, I have a little bit about Mississippi, where welfare funds go and stuff like that. Maybe I can stop here. And if folks are interested, I can say a little bit more about that, but I feel like I got a chance to, give you my ideas about, where I stand on that. So thank you for your time, and I look forward to your comments.
Thank you so much, Smitha. I'm very excited about your new project.
Thank you.
So we're open for Q&A. If you have a question, please drop it in the chat. While you're thinking about your questions, I have a couple of questions.
Great.
I'm very keen on this idea of there's something that you were talking about, the state in India, which goes in contradistinction to the general idea of liberalized India, right?
Yes.
Which is that it takes on a larger regulatory function while diluting its responsibility for women's empowerment, as well as divesting itself it's the responsibility of any sort of collateral or overheads or personal charges, and moving that on to private companies, right?
Yes.
So tell us a bit more about, what do you think that makes the state look like? What is the state in liberalized India, right?
Yes.
Secondly, I'm very keen to know, you told about how, multiple MFIs target the same group, right? Yeah. They're over-targeted and people tend to take multiple debts out, right?
Yes.
And yet some groups still get left out because they can't show their credit worthiness. But being too much in debt, as opposed to not having any cash, how does that sort of change exclusivity, or does that change something about social dynamics, right?
Yes.
Not just of women, but in other forms as well. I mean, I do have lots of questions about women in the US, but I'll wait for somebody else. Okay.
Should I get started on those, or do you want to collect a few? Or I haven't been looking.
What would you like to do? Would you like to respond to that?
I can start out with some thoughts about that, and then maybe if other folks want to chime in. So these are great questions, Amrita. I really appreciate them. So, this question of what is the state in liberalized India, I mean, this is, I think it's a big question. And I think looking at these histories definitely changed the way that I think about it. One of the things that I talk about, I didn't get too much into the theoretical framework that I use in the book, but it's there in the chapter. There is some literature that kind of looks at how do we understand a post-colonial state that's also liberalizing, right? And one of the things that we don't look at often enough is has to do with the transnational influences, right? And so in the case of Nabard, right, Nabard was very much subject to transnational influences from Grameen, from the international arena about microfinance and about small loans for women way back in the 80s. Right? They are already laying out these programs and they're already thinking about it in a lot of depth, right? And they are planning actively about how to roll this out. Now, this isn't the only thing that's going on. There is the Mahila Samiti movement that's underway. There's so many other kinds of movements that are thinking about women's empowerment holistically. Nabard never thought like, okay, we're going to be the only game in town on this, but they're crafting these policies very much in response to what's going on in the transnational policy environment around women and development. Mm-hmm. Now, at that same time, the RBI is concerned with licensing. They're concerned with, how are we going to get banks to, they're trying to figure out, all right, well, they basically take away all the licensing requirements. So that 1-to-4 ratio, they kind of take it away to try to encourage private banks to come onto the scene. They want to offer more financial products really to middle-class Indians. Mm-hmm. And they don't want to deregulate the whole thing, right? But they're thinking about it in very gender-neutral ways. They're concerned with the rural-urban divide, but they're really trying to get banks to be much more active, right? And so they have totally different concerns. And it's almost like they're all doing their own things with their own sets of influences. RBI is also influenced by transnational policy conversations, but those are around deregulation. And feeling like, oh, we're too regulated, but we don't want to get into the Wild West either. So, how are we going to keep our regulations? How are we going to deregulate from, the kind of bureaucratic garage that was there before of red tape, but be kind of lean, but at the same time, not go too far that our markets go into a windfall. These are just two different conversations, but they end up converging when MFIs kind of bridge that, right? And then start dealing directly with the RBI for regulation, right? And so that's where I think we've kind of misunderstood microfinance as kind of this market-led intervention targeting women. It's way more than that. It has to do with the history of banking in India. It has to do with all of these different regulations and institutions. And we kind of like miss seeing the forest for the trees when we have too narrow a conceptualization of what actually happened. So I think that it's a way that we can look at how disaggregated the state is and the different kinds of influences that are happening at the same time, and that it's, you know, we can't cohesively theorize what this liberalized state looked like, you know, looks like, and even just looking at one product leads us to in very different directions. So, you know, I hope that's something that will be helpful or you know, instructive for other scholars to take up. And as far as the debt versus exclusion, I mean, I almost feel like that's, you know, an ethical or a philosophical question, you know, like, is it better to be overly exploited or not exploited at all, right? Like, it's sort of this Marx, a Gramscian kind of question. I mean, it, you know, it's a big question, but, you know, I do think for those who are completely excluded from these debt circuits, my preliminary, so I have a colleague, Farine Parvez at UMass Amherst, who's been doing work with very poor Muslim communities in Hyderabad, who have been targeted in recent years due to religious violence. They would love to have access to MFIs. All they have access to is the most predatory debt there is. And that's like predatory exclusion, right? Like they would love, you know, and there are one of the MFIs that I looked at, they have these, you know, CSR community social responsibility, corporate social responsibility programs where they go to really, really marginalized families and give them various types of, you know, direct support in order that the women can graduate and take a loan from their organization, right? Like they actually see that as an accomplishment. So there's predatory inclusion, but it's like exclusion is maybe like not even viable, you know, like with the predatory inclusion, predation is happening, but they're sort of moving the money around, even if they're not moving up. Right. And unfortunately, this type of, when I explain this, people take it as like, well, don't you see the MFIs are doing good? It's like, well, but they're doing that in the absence of any social supports. They're basically filling in things that the state ought to be providing. I have an automatic lighting system. So if I stay still for too long, it goes off. So anyway, that's my preliminary thoughts about that.
Thank you, Smitha. Okay, Apurva has a question, and then after that, Jasmeet has a question. Maybe we can take it together. Yeah.
Thank you, Smitha. This is fantastic. I just wanted to clarify whether are you arguing that it's in some way the fact that there is so much state-sanctioned gendered debt in India has somehow also been disempowering? I know you're trying to see the overlap between the empowerment discourse, yes. And, but are you going as far as saying it has been disempowering? And if yes, in what ways? And I want to basically push you to try and see or try and respond to the findings in, say, some political science literature recently suggesting that membership or SSG membership has actually improved political participation of women, even sort of pushing them to perhaps enter electoral races and not just be stand-ins for men. So yeah, just a couple of those. Thank you.
Yeah, so I think both things can be true. You know, as we know, the definition of empowerment is highly contested. There are many different conceptions of what that means. You know, and I think that the economic, the political, and the community-oriented definitions of empowerment, you know, all exist and they're all relevant, right? And so, yes, it might be that SHG members, due to the fact that they come out and connect with one another, may be more likely to participate politically, doesn't necessarily mean they have any better access to the job market, right? Or that they have that they're better able to hang on to property that's in their name or be able to access their inheritance, right? I don't think anything I'm saying is contradicting what's there. Both can be true. You know, in fact, many of the women that I talk to, they are politically involved in parties. They're doing, you know, and that's the other thing is that, you know, the folks who are taking these loans, whether it's SHG loans or MFI loans, they are a very heterogeneous group, you know? So, you know, within the same community, the same little alleyway, right, in Bangalore, you will have women who are basically party bosses, right, who are taking loans from MFIs, right, and not using it themselves, but ghost lending to all these other women who can't afford to get that loan themselves. And they're doing it because, and they're able to do that because they have tremendous political power in local politics, right? So I don't know, like it's empowering them, I suppose, you know, but it's disempowering. So I think it, we've come to a point where, you know, this word empowerment has kind of become a little bit of smoke and mirrors, and, you know, we are not really talking with any kind of clarity. That's why whenever I use it in my book, I put it in quotes, because it's become, you know, a word that, like, what are we talking about anyway, you know, and can we talk about women's livelihoods in more nuanced ways? Sure, they can come together and, you know, go ahead and say, like, be more vocal about, you know, women who are experiencing domestic violence, for example, or they can better know how to get their kid a job because they're meeting the other women all the time in these groups, right? What about the women who don't pay back, who are excluded? You know, I went, and that was very hard for me to research, because when you go to the meeting, you see who's there, not who's not there, you know, but when you look around, you know, and I saw this, you know, there was a woman on the margins of one meeting that I went to who was not a part of the group, and people were like whispering about her, right? And I went and talked to her, and she's like, yeah, I wasn't able to take the loan this time, but I'm gonna see if I can take it with them next time. She didn't have a thali, for example. She was wearing, you know, it was just thread, right? And she was living in very, very, simple is an understatement, like very bare accommodations, right? She had clearly experienced significant financial distress. She had been excluded from those networks where women are gaining empowerment, right? So I think that we need to now be a little bit more nuanced and specific when we're talking about that. And just saying that, you know, well, some of the SHG, they have access to political power. Fantastic. You know, that's great. Like, that doesn't mean that, you know, we're not at a point anymore that we need to say it's good or bad. You know, are we still in that moment that we need to be talking about impact in such a unidimensional way? You know, I think that we can have a more nuanced conversation about it, and we must. You know, we need to get beyond this sort of, you know, like, is the impact good or not? We're still stuck in this economistic framing. Like, do their impacts go up? Do they feel more empowered? You know, when you go and ask women, like, oh, how was that training? Did you feel you benefited? You know, they'll be like, yes, it was nice. Because they're incredibly kind and resourceful. And if you come and ask them, they're gonna tell you what they think you would like them to say, because they would like to be helpful, right? And I think that we, you know, that doesn't mean that we can't advocate for change on their behalf because of the circumstances. They're making the best use of what they have and doing it in an incredibly resourceful way. You know, that doesn't mean that we can't and shouldn't be advocating for you know, a much more holistic understanding of their livelihoods, and having that understanding drive our policies rather than a kind of very thin or unidimensional understanding of empowerment.
Just me?
Yeah. Hi. Thank you, Amrita, and thank you very much, Smitha, for this amazing talk. I'm sorry. I apologize. I won't be able to switch on my camera right now.
No problem.
I was doing some field work in Rajasthan, where I was working in some Dalit neighborhoods, and I noticed this sort of nexus of geography, castes, and banking system, and debt. And it was fascinating because there was no MFI at all. What existed were these very predatory sort of, you know, society schemes where you put money and so on and so forth. And I was just sort of wondering, well, you know, what's happening with caste and microfinance, both from the point of view of givers, the companies that are giving these loans, but also the takers, and why in some areas you would have these MFIs, like, you know, sort of flourishing, and in other areas you would have these sort of predatory exclusive sort of, you know, mechanisms that you pointed out. So yeah. Thank you so much once again.
No, that's a great observation, Jasmeet, and I would love to hear more about that area in Rajasthan that you're talking about. You know, and I think I don't have a very direct answer. I have circumstantial evidence. So the data, the official data on self-help group membership as well as MFI membership suggests that a large proportion of these borrowers do come from Dalit communities. But what that actually, what the geography of that looks like, I think is a much more complicated question, and one that I would like to look into more. And it's difficult to study, because I think that some of that within the urban neighborhoods that I looked at, I think they are very mixed in caste composition, and that there are, you know, layers of class and caste complexity and domination that I couldn't untangle when looking at it just from the vantage point of MFIs. So I think that there is a bigger story there that is regional and geographic. In urban areas, some of those things get compressed, I think. Now, about the schemes that you talked about, those are often caste-based, and that's that legacy of that earlier moment, right? Like where you have, I mean, in the South, there's chit funds, for example. They're generally among a lot of working class folks in India, financial companies have like a really bad reputation, right? And so that's something which I don't think has gone away entirely. And it's because there are these very dubious actors that exist. And compared to them, MFIs are like angels, right? Because they have clear procedures. Once they are regulated, after the Maligam thing, they don't behave in a coercive way. And I talk about some of those things in the book. You know, they treat the borrowers like elder sisters. You know, they don't demean them in that way. And so I also think there's another question about caste that needs to be looked at, which is how caste functions within MFIs. My hunch, although I only have anecdotal data from my research to support this, is that those who work for MFIs, whom I show in my book, actually profit the most, because those folks who go in with an entry-level job, if they rise up within the MFI, they actually enter the kind of middle class. Of course, these are very small numbers compared to the borrowers, right? My hunch is that those folks tend to be upper caste and are probably less likely to be Dalit than the borrowers. And that's because the way that folks are recruited, they are recruited within family networks. So 9 out of 10 of the people that I interviewed, right, 90% of them said, my brother told me to go and interview for this job. My uncle told me about this, right? And so I think that there are these caste networks through which hiring happens. And those are the folks that actually end up doing pretty well. I did interview a few folks who explicitly identified as Dalit, who work for MFIs, who have experienced some upward mobility. And many of them talked about not being able to get into the upper echelons of those organizations, which are very dominated by dominant caste men. So I think there is a kind of ceiling there on the basis of caste and some serious barriers within organizations that have not really been studied. So I know that was a little bit outside of your question about geography, Smith, but just something that came to mind.
Thank you, Smitha. Tariq has a question, and then Bhumi has a question.
Great.
Smitha, really enjoyed the presentation. Thank you so much. And it's an exciting project. And I was just kind of thinking of a couple of things I found interesting that in case it's helpful to, as you're Great. Thinking through the next step. So one, I thought it was really interesting how reputation worked, like the construction of reputation on both sides, right? So you had both lending institutions having reputations among borrowers, as you just said, and what kind of goes into that, but also the reputations of borrowers themselves. So it was interesting. I really liked the historical point of how men became bad borrowers. And what was interesting was that women, while I understand the overall fact of like high repayment rates, even post-crisis, maybe they have stickier reputations. You know, there's a kind of gender difference there in terms of staying good borrowers, even if there are realities that might cut both ways on both sides. And I'm sure there's a similar story that could be told with caste or occupation, et cetera. But the kind of composition of reputation was something that was really interesting. And I think the combination of ethnography and historical work is really well poised to kind of advance our understanding of. The second thing was just, building on Apurva's point, I think, and actually your response to it, I think it would be, we're at a great moment and your project would be a great place to kind of think about that variation, that heterogeneity of experience, mm-hmm. Which is so much more interesting, I agree, than like a single kind of argument about, is this good or is this bad? And there are at least two dimensions that I've been thinking about. One is, self-help groups are one dimension of that, but you mentioned NREGA, cash assistance, so not just debt, but even the giving of benefits. And yes. Now there's this whole discourse of women as beneficiaries, labharthis. It's very politicized, but it's also very present within India. And so I think it's an interesting moment to move not just beyond, I mean, maybe this is going too far for this project, but borrowers are only one instantiation of how women are being seen. Women are also currently being seen as very good beneficiaries. They're good at receiving benefits beyond just loans. And
What's the term that you said is being
labharti? I'll type it in the chat box, which is just beneficiary in some ways.
Yeah.
But I think that it might be interesting to think about almost maybe in an interdisciplinary setting. Maybe it's too much for one person to do, but we do have a lot of all of this variation about effects that are potentially helpful to women, those that are not, but also how those are unevenly distributed against different kinds of women. And I don't think there's been enough effort to aggregate, even in conversation, forget about in a single work,
right,
across these different kinds of domains and different kinds of methodologies. And I think I'm not putting that on you, but I'm just thinking about that as being a potentially important set of conversations that you should definitely be, you know, at the heart of. Anyway,
yeah, thank you. Disciplines do you feel like people are, or what spaces are people even talking about? I feel like I don't.
So self-help groups have become, as Apurva said, like a lot of the work on female political participation in political science has really thought about self-help groups because of their pervasiveness. And there's been very interesting work on that. But again, it's been kind of thinking about it in one particular kind of way. I think it would benefit from hearing your work as much as vice versa. And thinking about political ambition is very different from some of the kinds of indebtedness or social collateral and the kind of dark side of lending that you were talking about. Mm-hmm. But I also think there's been some interesting work that's happening in kind of social anthropology that's thinking about what the act of working does. I think that, you know, when, if you're thinking about narega, female labor force participation now from economics to anthropology is something that a lot of people are interested in. But often it's like, you know, why are women working or why are they not working? But there's less work on what is the experience of work or access to work doing and not doing, at least in my understanding. So I think that would be another dimension to kind of think through.
That's really helpful. Thank you so much, Tai.
Can we also take questions from Bhumi just for the sake of time before you rest on?
Hi, Smitha. Thank you so much. This was really great work, and I'm excited to get my hands on your book. I specifically am wondering if you could tease out more how MFIs construct women as autonomous from the household. So this kind of builds on Tariq's point about this reputation associated with women as being better repayers, but that also seems in contradiction to the reality, specifically in India, where women's bargaining power vis-a-vis financial decisions in the household is limited. So how does this duality work in how MFIs target women?
Oh, great question, Bhumi. Thank you. So this is something that I looked at a lot in the space of training. So my initial interest in this project before I got into this whole mess of, you know, financialization and blah, 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 was actually about that. How is it that MFIs are approaching women? What kind of women do they want to make, right? And how can we observe what the interactions are between MFIs? So I picked training as the site to do that, because that's when you can really see, like, what are the pedagogical strategies? What kind of materials are they handing out, right? What is the response from the participants? What does that actually look like? And so, you know, I think that there is a great effort on the part of MFIs to basically convince women that they are financial managers, that they are mothers, that they can be many things, that they can be householders, they can be workers, they can be responsible. They kind of outline for them in a lot of financial literacy programs that I looked at, you know, how, like, and they're often with, like, cartoons and, like, with different kinds of, you know, materials, like, you know, you can be happy or you can be sad. Like, there's a kushi and there's like a suki and there's a duki. You know, there's like, you know, and you know, it sort of really calls upon women to be responsible mothers in terms of their management of the financial resources in the family. And I think that is an incredibly powerful framing, because it both resonates with women's experiences of being part of households and calls upon them to basically do more, to make sure that they are, you know, doing everything they can to utilize the loans that they have, to, you know, make sure they open up a bank account, make sure they utilize the resources that are available to them, and all of that. So I think that's the findings are that they call upon them as mothers. And there's some different discourses that are out there, like, you're an entrepreneur, you know, you're a financial manager, you're a worker, you know, there are some competing discourses of that, but they all are very much within, they come back to the what I, in the book I call it working motherhood, right? That they that's the way they kind of call upon them. And you know, I think there's more work to do because of course these things are not stable, and there are many women who would reject that and say that, you know, and I talk about that as well, who are like, you know, I don't want to hear about being an entrepreneur, like I got to take care of, I got to cook for my kids. Or, you know, I mean, people who were entrepreneurs being like, why would I call myself an entrepreneur? Like I'm a woman, you know, and I'm a mother and I don't want to be called that. Thank you. You know, so there, it's not that this is something, you know, going back to Tariq's comments about heterogeneity and reputation, you know, women are also selecting how they want to engage with these organizations. They're not just, you know, swallowing it whole in any way, you know? So I think that's the type, that sort of working motherhood ideal is what MFIs are putting forth. And some women are really attracted to that. And some are just like, thanks, I'm gonna take care of my family, take your loan and please get out of my life, right? Like, so there's a whole range of ways in which I think borrowers engage.
Shikhar, do you have something to add?
Oh no, I was just intrigued how in recent years there has been this practice of gold-based loans. And it seems to be like all the macroeconomic virtues of it are routinely parroted by the powers that be, but it seems to have some very real implications in terms of who's repaying, who's responsible, and whose assets are going back. If you could say something about that, thank you.
Yes, the gold loan thing, I feel like, I mean, I had this whole project that the thing is, I can't figure out a methodology, which is why I don't know it, but like, of just follow the gold in India is like the ultimate gendered, like financial project, you know, like figure out what, and these gold loans, and a lot of them do MFIs now, they do microfinance. A lot of the gold banks, the gold loan banks also have microfinance wings. And I actually studied some of those and like am a little more familiar than I want to be with some of the inner workings of it because I couldn't publish a lot of that stuff. But, you know, they are, you know, very, very popular. They are less exploitative than the pawnbrokers because they have clear set of rules and there is a procedure. I mean, I talk a lot about the standardization of procedure as being a major thing that MFIs put into place that didn't exist before. I think the gold loan folks have done that as well. But the way they are tapping into very similar constructions of the woman as the ideal borrower who will pay back. A lot of women I talked to got their MFI loans to pay back their gold loans, whether they were with a bank or whether they're with a pawnbroker. You know, it's sometimes hard to get that clarity on that information in interviews, but you know, they are people want their gold back, and they are, but they also pawn it. That's the first thing, the first asset to be pawned. Yeah, I mean, the women are incredibly resourceful about how they use those resources. And yeah, I think there's a whole nother project on like dowry, gold loans, how they travel through families, how they get traded, how women get dispossessed of their gold. You know, and I'm just like shocked that there isn't more work on that. To me, that's just like such a good project, like waiting to be done. But I think the methodology is difficult. Like interviews are not going to quite get at it. You know, at like, where do you go and hang out at weddings where they're exchanging these things? Like that would be hard to do. Like practically speaking, I still have not been able to come up with like, what would be a good methodology to follow the gold. I really don't know, but I wish someone would do that. Thank you for that question.
Yeah, we're nearly out of time. Sharad, do you have a quick question and then we'll come to...
Yeah, we are already past 1 o'clock, so but I'll still ask a question about the historical background because I couldn't help but notice the historical background that you highlighted. So one question that I have about that is, I mean, because 1880s is exactly the time when there's a lot of financial decentralization is happening with the British colonial state. So is the incentive for social banking coming from that sort of decentralization? Or what is actually driving the colonial state in social banking? And I'm also kind of really curious about the role of women in these financial decentralization projects because women is usually missing in the story of financial history in colonial India. And I'm also wondering about is the argument that you're trying to make is that whatever the colonial state did with social banking have an impact on how the post-colonial state come to understand social banking, or is it just a question of giving a historical background? Okay, say like looking at 1880s as a point where some sort of banking, social banking existed, but not necessarily shaped the latter, like the post-colonial banking.
Okay, so
I know you're out of time, but yeah.
Okay, now I'll quickly, I know the answer to the second question, but not the first. So I don't know enough about the history of the British colonial banking, like what their enterprise was, what they were motivated by, and so on. The second question is that, yes, I think it's directly related, because the fact that the British set up the origins of what ended up becoming the post-colonial banking system, that stratification, it kind of like, we're still grappling with the legacy of that, right? Because of the way that it was set up. And, you know, that trust deficit, you know, that folks in rural areas just not trusting the lender, you know, of course that has to do with elite domination and caste domination and, you know, land and all these other things. But I think that also has to do with the fact the way the British rolled out that social banking system. And I'm not the only one to say, like, this was a new area for me when I started reading this literature. So it's other folks who have said that essentially, you know, there are these long legacies of what happened during that time period. The British weren't the only game in town. There were other caste-based banking system that I talk about in more depth in the book that were kind of competing for these borrowers, but they all had different kinds of exclusivity. But yes, I think they do very prominently influence the shape of the post-colonial system that, you know, and that in a way MFIs are still trying to, you know, sort of figuring out what has been plaguing that for a long time, but they end up solving it in a completely different way. And there is precious little, I searched, but probably not hard enough or long enough for one part of one chapter to find women in histories of banking, of British finance. And they're hard to find even when you're looking for them. Widows, they show up as widows. We know from the literature on indenture that many women, because of financial exclusion, you know, boarded ships, because they weren't included, and that might have included a kind of banking transaction to actually board an indentured ship. So I think there's a lot. Probably have to look in other places to find where the women are during that period and what kinds of financial transactions they're undertaking.
All right, thank you, everyone. We come to the end of another seminar series. I'd like to thank our speaker, Smitha. Thank you so much for such an exciting conversation.